Good morning.
Hi.
So much amazing energy in this room. And what a fabulous, how great Tony was. I love like the energy. We need more men like Tony, but we also need more women like Kirsten. Kirsten's in a really interesting intersection in the entrepreneurial arena. She's someone who started a venture fund and has backed some of the most formidable consumer brands like Warby Parker and Glossier, but she's also someone who's deeply committed to closing gaps, especially through an organization like All Raise, which is dedicated to getting more women within the funding arena, because we know there are so many systemic barriers that we have to overcome. So we all know that the statistics are really bleak in terms of access to funding. Less than 3% of all funding goes to women, even bleaker for women of color. 65% of venture firms still don't have a female partner. Talk a little bit about where we are today and why having more women write checks and lead deals can have such a seismic impact in changing the landscape of business as we know it.
Yeah, thanks for the tee up, Moira. And what an amazing day this is, and what an amazing title this day is, Embracing Ambition, because that is a theme that we have been really working on really earnestly in Silicon Valley, particularly as it relates to women and diverse founders. In Silicon Valley, as venture capitalists, our job and our role is hopefully to be part of ushering in new companies that are thinking about the world as it's moving and changing and building businesses for the future that hopefully over time have positive impacts on everybody. And when you think about kind of what everybody means, that's men, women, that's people of all colors, races, genders, and the businesses need to be designed to suit those audiences. And if you know, it's kind of obvious if you think about what it takes to be in touch with those audiences. It's about having diverse teams. And for too long, in venture capital in particular, which is the earliest stages of funding those kind of businesses, it's been dominated by men, and it's been dominated by men of a certain kind of class or kind. And so as we think about kind of bringing the diversified energy into the companies of the future, it's vital to have people of diversity as part of the constituents. So that means more female and diverse founders founding the companies, more founders in general having an awareness for the value of diverse teams and structuring their leadership teams all the way down to the junior people contributing to kind of look like the audience they're serving and be diverse. And a big part of bringing those companies to life, or a part of bringing those companies to life in the early days, is the funding sources. And when you're investing in an early stage business, you are looking for that game-changing company that can break out. You are trying to understand where the markets are moving and look for things in that opportunity. But you're also about to go on a journey with a founder, with an entrepreneur, for a decade. Or more. And in that respect, like, the relationship, the ability to kind of forge a partnership and trust with each other is really important. And I think one part of that ingredient is the personal connection. Another part about it is, I think about this too, like, I don't want to impart too much of my own wishes or desires into companies, but I can't help it if I can relate to the problem, if I understand the audience that they're going after, the opportunity to have an affinity for that or feel more passionate about it and be more engaged. It's a real factor. And so you need people that are of that broader audience to be part of the check writing ecosystem too. And so those stats you said are unacceptable. You mentioned All Raise, which is a group about empowering diverse founders, female and diversity founders, and funders. And we wanted to raise the bar. We wanted to say we want more venture capital dollars to go to ambitious female entrepreneurs, and we want more female check writers. And we think if that's a starting point, we'll end up with more companies that have diverse leadership teams, that have diversity all the way down the spectrum. And while the numbers are still low, they have gone from 2 years ago where 9% of the general partners, which are kind of the check writers or the board members at venture capital firms, up to 13%. So we've got a ways to go. Our goal is to get much beyond that, but it's some good progress. And the dollars going to women are still not what they were, but we had a handful of women this year raise record amounts of money for companies that have built value already and are continuing to grow. So it's an important moment. The attention is on us. The conversation is live. It's happening in the investment community. It's happening in other communities. And I think that, like, there's results being shown, which is, you know, obviously the important driver of it, to show, like, companies that have that type of makeup are outperforming and they're better. And those results are starting to come in. And I think it's just the beginning of a tidal wave moment.
You know, you talk about, you're at a stage when entrepreneurs are getting to the venture table. I think we all agree that we need more women, you know, raising their hands to strike out on their own and start their own businesses. Tory's been such a big proponent of entrepreneurs. How many female founders are in this room today? Which is amazing.
Yay.
Amazing.
Good for you.
Amazing. Yeah. And the other thing I would say is, in this moment in time, even if you aren't an entrepreneur, you have to really embrace sort of this entrepreneurial mindset to be able to thrive in business today. You're someone who sees so many entrepreneurs. And one of the things that I hear from aspiring female founders, they feel they don't have the right skill sets or the right background, given that there sometimes is a narrative around what it takes. What are the common threads that unite the entrepreneurs you've seen that have achieved such uncommon success? And how should others think about, if they've had an untraditional background or one that doesn't seem like, you know, the stereotypical background to become an entrepreneur, how do you think they should think about translating different types of experiences in the context of still being able to be a viable and successful founder?
Yeah. So I think there are some common traits of successful founders. I don't think there are necessarily common backgrounds of people who are successful founders. At our firm, Forerunner Ventures, we've invested in almost 100 different early stage businesses, and founders have a wide makeup. We have 40% or close to it that are female versus male. Some people went to maybe what people think of as kind of a more common path, college, grad school, had a job in the particular industry, and maybe a seat at the leadership table, and then wanted to translate and take that further. We have some of those. We have people who didn't go to college. We have people that dropped out of college. We have people that had careers in an entirely different field, but couldn't get this idea and this opportunity out of their mind and wanted to bring it to life, which I think a common thread around founders is that they have an idea, they have a desire, they have a vision for something, and they can't get it out of their head. I think, you know, really having an idea about, like, what is the problem you're solving, who is the audience you're serving, how are they going to determine value, and what is it going to take to bring that to life are, like, the critical kind of, you know, foundational things to have in mind as you think about building a business. There is all kinds of ways to be an entrepreneur and start a business. I work in venture capital. I mentioned earlier, like, we are trying to kind of really aim for businesses that are in the path of changing the landscape of business, and I'm generic word, but it's relevant disruptor. Not every business is that. There's a lot of good businesses that start every day that have an incredible service or an incredible product that has a place in the market and that has real opportunity, and they could be funded in different ways. But in all cases, I think, you know, what I've come to notice is some common traits of founders that are successful is that they have real interest in what they're doing. They're doing it, you know, yes, they want to be successful, yes, they want to make money, they want to make a living in that regard, success, but they also really believe the product needs to be there and the service needs to be there, and they feel like they're, and I think it's important because starting a business is hard and it's going to be lonely and there's going to be challenges, but if you have that deep conviction that there's a place in the world for it and the world is going to be better because you have it, it gets you through that time period. Building a business is going to mean also building a community and getting a whole bunch of different resources around the table. I play a role in the context of money and hopefully being a supportive partner, but there are employees you need to hire, and there are consumers and users you need to get. And it does start with the founder, and it does start with the energy that they put forward to begin attracting those other people, which will become the culture, which will become the collective, which will stand for kind of moving the engine forward. And you do have to have a vision about where you're going, but be able to also tie it back to practicality and understand that, like, you can't do everything. You have to think about priorities and sort of pace yourself and think about where you can kind of drive the most value by selecting fewer things.
Yeah, I want to sort of tie back to the theme of the summit, which is embrace ambition. When we were sitting down together last summer, we were talking about your insights for entrepreneurs, and you said to me, quote, put, and the advice that you would give, you would say to aspiring entrepreneurs, quote, put all of your ambition out there and really own it. Own what you know, own what you don't know, and be okay with that. And never be afraid to dream big. Share how you have learned to embrace your own ambition and any advice for others around doing the same, because it's much easier said than done when it comes to your own life.
It's really true. And I think, you know, I can speak to it from my own perspective, because I really went on a journey to start Forerunner. It was a path that I kind of led to that place, and along the way, while I was while I was headed that direction, a lot of people kind of tell me why it was hard, why I couldn't do it, why I should maybe join a firm here or do that, or maybe I was just kind of nuts for thinking about doing it. And I think in every moment, I took those comments seriously and I thought about it, but I found myself translating it into kind of more motivation, maybe more rigor around my process too, to really challenge whether it was a good idea, whether it was the right idea. But at some point, it became like a calling as much as anything. And, you know, and then it's about putting something out into the world and intention and manifesting it. And part of doing that is all the things we talked about earlier, but it is not being afraid to embrace your ambition and owning that, and knowing that, like, if you fail, everybody fails, we all have failures. It's par for the course in life. I think if you're not failing at some point, you're not trying hard enough, and you can recover. I see it happen every day. One of the most incredible honors of working side by side with entrepreneurs is obviously seeing them grow and develop into leaders of bigger companies and their businesses flourish. But that doesn't happen all the time. And a lot of times it's really, really hard and really, really humbling. And sometimes it's defeating. But every single time I've seen those people be able to pick themselves back up. So I don't think you should get stuck in fear or worry, because there's a new day on the other side of it. And that's one of the most amazing things about careers today. I feel like when I started working, people were much more kind of like programmatic about how a career unfolded and how you needed to get kind of promotions. There's a lot more chance to be free and take liberties with it today. So don't hold back.
Well, I love that. We're grateful to you for having embraced your ambition, because you're helping to change the face of an industry and ultimately sort of change the face of business and opportunity as we know it. So thank you.
Thank you
to all
of you. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Have a good day.